Hi there. Over a year ago now, we released a video called 5 More of the Best Pet Lizards You Could Possibly Get, and it featured 5 stinking rad pet lizards. This one, the bearded anole or Cuban false chameleon, was probably simultaneously the weirdest and the most reasonable to keep lizard on that whole list. And they were all good pet lizards. And I feel that I need to be very specific about this because a lot of people, when they saw that I was bitten by my false water cobra, thought that I had been bitten by a actual cobra. So I need to be clear that this is a false chameleon, and the false means it isn't a chameleon. This is an anole. Or an anole, which is what I grew up calling them, only disappointingly to find out that anole is the more proper pronunciation. It's the worst, you'll hear me saying both. But this isn't a chameleon at all. That said, it does have many rad chameleon features, and that's cool because chameleons are arguably the coolest animals on the planet. One of these things that's very, very chameleon-like are their eyes. They've got those independently moving eyes, just like chameleons. And that means they can be looking in 2 totally different directions at the same time, and they usually only bring them together when they've found something that they want to eat and they need to get a little bit of depth perception. And they will stick their tongue out and use it to grab things, sort of like a chameleon, except it's nowhere near as long. They actually lunge with their whole body to grab things. And the truth is that being a lizard that in the wild is primarily feeding on snails, you don't need that same level of ambush that chameleons do. So you can usually get pretty close and use your tiny little tongue to lap up those snails. Then they roll them around in their mouth and kind of mash up that shell. It's the coolest thing, and that's the way they eat almost everything. It's really funny to watch them eat. They have that traditional snail eater way of rolling stuff around before you swallow it. As we already mentioned, you know, they've got some good chameleon-like features. And if you've seen our head-to-head video with the false chameleon versus the panther chameleon, which I would consider to be one of the most reasonable chameleons you can keep, the false chameleon won that hands down, largely because they're way more reasonable to keep than our true chameleons. But other things that are a little bit chameleon-like, they can change colors, nowhere near as much as chameleons do. In fact, lots of lizards change colors like these guys do, but they can go all the way from being almost white in color to almost black and sort of a number of different browns. And I've even seen some like mossy looking greens. So they actually turn all sorts of different colors, but just not the bright colors that you get out of some chameleons. They don't have a prehensile tail like chameleons do, where they can really grab stuff, but you can see it's semi-prehensile. They use it for an anchor, and that's pretty neat. They don't have the mitten-like chameleon hands. What they have instead are good toe pads like other anoles or sort of like geckos have, and they can climb right up glass as a result. That's stinking rad. And then they've got these wild scales. These aren't very chameleon-like. In fact, they remind me of the chameleon geckos, the Eurydactyloides geckos. We've actually got a whole video on them. And those geckos are stinking rad. And these guys are stinking rad. Both of them have these cool scales, and I don't really see very many chameleons with scales like that. So it seems to be something that the animals that people think should be called false chameleons have in common with one another that they don't have in common with chameleons. Funny that. They do have this sort of casque to their head, a lot like chameleons, and the little spikes on their beard, a lot like chameleons. They can actually puff up a big dewlap, which is just a good anole feature that they have. Really, these guys are very much like other anoles and only superficially like chameleons. But they've kind of got a lot of the best chameleon features right there, and they're way more reasonable to keep. The question really isn't, is the Cuban false chameleon a reasonable lizard to keep, because it totally is. And it definitely isn't, is it an unusual lizard to keep, because it totally is. And this is why it's already been on a list of amazing pet lizards. This is why it's already won a head-to-head with another lizard that I think is great. But the real question is, is the Cuban false chameleon the right pet lizard for you? And to help you figure this out, we have scored the Cuban false chameleon based on our five categories, which are handleability, care, hardiness, availability, and upfront costs. When it comes to handleability, and you will see this very, very clearly during this video, we give the Cuban false chameleon a score of 5 out of 5. They are kind of small. This is a male, and the males are a little bit bigger than females. You can see they're not a huge lizard. And that is really a place where they almost could lose a point because a small child or something could injure them more easily than other lizards. But the truth is they're not real small. I mean, they're kind of small, but they're not real small. And other than that, they're just unbelievably good to handle. They're calm. It's almost boring how calm they are. Honestly, if I was gonna give you a reason why you might not want a Cuban false chameleon, it is simply because they're too calm. They are so unbelievably laid back. Of my two Cuban false chameleons, this is the one that I handle almost never. And look at how calm he is with handling. He's just calm as a cucumber. They're not gonna scratch you up. They do have some little claws and you can feel them, but they're not gonna cut you at all. They're not gonna bite you. And this is different from chameleons and from their relatives, the night anoles. I actually got a baby night anole when I concluded that I wasn't gonna be able to find a price I could afford on bearded anoles, the false chameleons. And then later on, I did wind up finding a pair. So I have a night anole as well, and I'll talk about him a little bit more during this video. Those are a lizard that might try to bite you. These guys, they're not gonna bite you. They're not biters. And they're very gentle, really, with their mouths when they take food. It's ridiculous, and then they just roll it around in there. So great. They're also arboreal. Which means that they're really good at holding on to things because otherwise they would be falling out of the trees all the time. So they're very good at being handled. Honestly, this might be the most insanely handleable lizard that there is. It's impossible for me to tell you how a lizard could be any easier to handle. They can jump, but you saw, like, they're not gonna jump just out into the wilderness. He's just like, I'm going to the shoulder. And that is a rare occurrence. That's as hard as they get. They're unbelievably easy. I can't imagine how a lizard could be any easier to handle than this. They're lovely and wonderful. And you'll notice too, if they jump off of you, it's not like they're gonna scurry off real fast. Like, he's just like, I'm back to being a stick. I'd noticed that you noticed I wasn't a stick. Well, now I'm a stick. When it comes to care, we give the Cuban false chameleon a score of 4 out of 5. The biggest key with these guys is gonna be hydration. You know, if you give them a water bowl, they might not ever recognize that that's water, and they could actually die of dehydration with like a huge water bowl right in there. What they need is water dripping. And so a dripping system is probably the easiest way to keep your false chameleons hydrated, but you can even take like a butter dish and poke a little hole with a pin in it and, you know, that'll work just fine too. It just means you've gotta do it manually every day. And so having an automated dripping system might be easier. Also, misting the enclosure occasionally can help, but that dripping water seems to really be the key. When it comes to their enclosure, you can use a lot of different types of enclosures. You can use screen enclosures or glass enclosures. It really depends on where you are. But make sure that there's plenty of vertical space. They do like to climb. They'll also use some horizontal space, but these are not a super active lizard, and so they don't need a tremendous amount of space, though they will appreciate it. Ultraviolet UVB lights, those are really important, and don't skimp on those, because metabolic bone disease is a real concern for these guys, especially the females who are producing eggs on a regular basis, potentially. They need a lot of calcium. And so ultraviolet light will be extremely important, as well as dusting the insects and other feeders that you give to them with calcium and other vitamin supplements. They need actually a fairly cool basking spot, but they do need a basking spot. And so you will want a low wattage basking bulb in addition to the UV bulbs. You're gonna want some sort of substrate that can hold some moisture and won't mold. And then I would cover that completely with sphagnum moss to really give you the right the right kind of humidity in the enclosure. If you want a good example of the type of enclosure that would be really good for these guys, I would actually reference you to the enclosure build that we did a while back. I would use a larger tank for that, and I would put a drainage layer in there, but that basic enclosure style would work just great for these guys. Also, something I would add are some thicker climbing branches that they can really hold on to, maybe about the thickness of the lizard itself. When it comes to food, these guys as adults are very easy to feed. Sometimes as babies, they can be kind of difficult. They're snail eaters in the wild, and getting a constant supply of clean snails is a big deal because snails can carry all kinds of nasty stuff. And so you don't want to get snails out of the wild. You want to get them captive bred and snails that have been bred in captivity for several generations. This can be difficult, and sometimes that's all that the babies really want. So to get them transitioned onto other feeders, if you don't have access to small, healthy snails, you're gonna have to assist feed them. And I actually still have to assist feed my female. She's never been a very good feeder on her own. The male's much better. That actually can be a pain, but usually if you get established adults, they're gonna be eating a variety of insects like dubia roaches, crickets, minorly superworms, and the occasional waxworm, and then they love them some snails, like canna snails, you know, and then if you can get live snails, even better. They're good eaters, and they don't need a ton of them. For those of you who are not current supporters on Patreon, I strongly encourage you to check out our page. One of the things that we have for our supporters on Patreon is our super secret podcast that's available only to our patrons. Just recently, we did a podcast with all of the members of the Clint's Reptile team. That means all six of us that work on these videos together while we were up at a cabin together, snowed in. And it was awesome, and that's something that's going to be available only to those of you who follow us on, or who support us on Patreon. And so that alone might be a reason to do it. When it comes to hardiness, we give the bearded anole or the false chameleon a score of 5 out of 5. Like I mentioned, babies may need to be assist fed, and you know, that was actually something I learned how to do with my baby night anole, so I was kind of prepared for it. Before I got these guys, it's not uncommon for baby anoles to not take this types of feeders that we have in captivity. And so you've kind of got to, it's easy to do, but you do have to do it. However, with proper hydration and UVB, they seem to be really hardy, which is very different from true chameleons. These guys seem to do really, really well. That's one of the reasons I recommend these guys to beginners. I mean, if you can find one of these, this is a great lizard for a beginner. When it comes to availability, we give the Cuban false chameleon a score of 3 out of 5. They are becoming more available. I'm seeing them more and more often all the time. So, you know, here in a year or two, you might be watching this video and be like, what are you talking about? They're in every pet store. But right now, you know, you can find them online from breeders. You can find them at expos fairly often. I've only seen them very rarely at pet shops. The truth is they're easy to get to breed. It's easy to get eggs out of them, but getting the eggs to hatch and then raising up the juveniles seems to be an art that we're still fine-tuning a little bit. I know even Emily at Snake Discovery, she and I got these at about the same time, and she's produced some babies, but I know it's been a challenge for her getting some of the eggs to hatch, and I don't think that's an uncommon experience. I'd strongly recommend that you check out her videos on those as well, because they're awesome, and I mean, she does such a great job, so check it out. Cuban false chameleons are out there, but you might need to look. When it comes to upfront costs, we give the Cuban false chameleon a score of 4 out of 5. The lizard itself is somewhat expensive, but when I was first getting into these guys, it seems like they were almost twice as much as I've seen them for more recently. So they're getting cheaper. Everything else about them is pretty darn reasonable. You can keep them in multiple different types of enclosures, you know, screen or glass. It really just depends on the climate, which one will probably work better for you. Just don't skimp on the UV lighting. And then I'd recommend a dripping system. We'll have links to all these things down in the description. But overall, it's not that expensive to keep one, at least once you've bought the lizard. And that is why, overall, we give the Cuban false chameleon a score of 4.2 out of 5. Which, especially for a lizard that's kind of hard to find, is a ridiculously high score. And it's ridiculously high because, as pets go, they're easy and they're pretty darn cool. They're definitely unusual and easy to interact with. There's a lot to love about the Cuban false chameleon. To be perfectly honest with you, though, you know, and this is a final consideration for you, I do find them to be a little bit boring, at least compared to, like, my night anole, who's very active and inquisitive and interested in me. Interacting with it is much harder. I can just go grab a Cuban false chameleon, even one that's never been handled before, and it's going to be great. You definitely have to build a relationship with a night anole before you get anything like that. But there's something kind of rewarding about that. These guys are really committed to being sticks. That's what they do. And so that would be the only reason I would say not to get one. But if what you want is a totally reasonable, strange stick that turns out to be a groovy snail-eating lizard, then the Cuban false chameleon just might be the perfect pet lizard for you. As always, like and subscribe, and we hope to see you real soon. Any easier...